Hey, I want to take a moment to thank everyone for their participation in our picnic yesterday. We had a great time, didn't we? I mean, it rained. We still had a great time. I want to thank all the workers. I want to personally thank Pastor Orlando and Noelle for their involvement. Amen. We had such a great time yesterday. I mean, we were in the pool. It was pouring rain, but it was great. I mean, the food, the fellowship, I mean, it was great. So I want to thank everybody that was involved. Just want to remind us, friends, our vision statement here is to inspire people to embrace and serve the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. We've been meeting for prayer on Saturday from 9 to 10. Join us if you can. We've been having really, really great prayer. We have a video to show you from last week. Last week we had our BGMC, our children's offering, so we have a video for you today.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you so much,
everyone. Hallelujah. It's me, Jeremiah, again. I'm so happy to report to you all that we met our goal of 500, but we didn't stop there. A big thanks to you all. We raised up to 900. Thank you, everyone who donated to BGMC. Our Lord is always faithful.
Isn't that wonderful? Their original goal was 300, then they raised it to 500. This is kids' church. And then as a result of last week, they raised $900 for missions. Isn't that great? So I want to thank the Lord for all the workers. We have over 15 workers in kids' church, and Jen oversees that department. So thank you so much, children. At this time, we want to wait on you for your tithes and your offerings. Ushers, would you come? By the way, we have a bunch of guests and friends with us today. Jen's friends, you guys have to stand up. Jessica, come on. Would you guys stand up? Come on. We want to recognize you today. These are Jen's friends. Come on. Hey. Thank you so much for having us. Jen has a group of ladies that they meet together. Jessica, stand up. Come on. Come over here. Come here. Come over here. This is my daughter. You know why I asked you to stand? Because I love you. praise God. Lord, thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercies that we got up this morning, that we had the mind to come to church and to serve you and to love you. We love you so much. We love you because you first loved us, Lord. We thank you for that. Bless our tithes and offerings. May they continue to be used to honor you and to advance your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Friends, today is a special day for our church. In 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 26, it says that when one member of the body is honored, that the members rejoice with it. In other words, when we honor one person in the church, we are all honored. And I'm thrilled that Jen Flaherty will be receiving her ministerial certificate today. As amen. As a commissioned minister. What is a commissioned minister? Well, it's a threefold process. Number one, it has to be sanctioned by the network superintendent, Pastor Don James. We are an Assembly of God church. Reverend James is pretty much the overseer here in New Jersey. There's 140 Assembly of God churches in New Jersey. By the way, there are 65 million people worldwide who are under the umbrella of the Assemblies of God. So we thank the Lord, and we're growing as a movement. Also, the process involves the senior pastor, myself, who has to endorse and approve the candidate and the credentialing process. The candidate will have to work in concert with the pastor, with myself, and it is a localized credentialing, the first step to additional credentialing. Thirdly, there's a written exam, a doctrinal theological exam. By the way, the exam is 5 pages long, and the very last question on the exam is to list the 16 fundamentals of faith and to give a scripture reference for that. So it's not an easy exam. By the way, I had an opportunity to grade the exam. And what do you think Jen got, right? An A+, right? You guys know Jen. Also, before Jen came to us, she has taken over 20 Bible courses. Actually, I have a copy of the transcript. She got all A's except one B. We're going to keep her humble. Patrick is shaking his head, yeah. Jen was appointed as an elder at her former church, extremely, extremely involved with the life of the church. Thus, biblical knowledge and experience is essential and mandatory for the credentialing process. I don't have to tell you that Jen is a remarkable, charismatic, engaging Christ follower. Jen has an unprecedented skill set. I have to be honest, friends, in the 40 years of ministry, I have never, ever met anybody with such a diverse professional, social, and spiritual skill set as Jen. She is really, really unique. Jen is the embodiment of loyalty, excellence, devotion, skill. Along with that, her wonderful personality, she's cordial, she's polished, she's spiritual, she's intelligent, professional. And I want to tell you, I don't have to tell you this, how much she loves our church. She loves us. She loves our church. I just thank the Lord so many times for Jen. You know, in the Bible, it talks about Moses, that story when they were battling the Amalekites. And you remember Aaron and her held up his arms. That's Jen. Jen is a certified public accountant. She also has her master's degree in business administration. I mean, she could be out there in the workforce, out in the secular workforce, but she volunteers as our church administrator. And everything she does with excellence. Amen, Fred. Amen. She is the quintessential staff member, our financial officer, volunteer, servant, oversees our kids' church. Jen is very visionary at our staff meetings, always has suggestions to strengthen and build our church and edify our church. She's passionate about the Lord, about the kingdom of God. She's a great teacher, Bible teacher, communicator. She was one of our facilitators for the Gospel of John. Another great thing about Jen, she has a very, very high regard for authority. Very, very loyal, very, very supportive. And I thank the Lord how she has ingratiated herself to all of us. And everybody said, amen. Amen. What is the function and role of a commissioned minister? Well, it doesn't come with a job description. It's basically a position of service whenever called upon by the senior pastor. And Jen is a servant. Whatever I asked her to do, as a matter of fact, there have been times where I have to say to her, no, we'll let somebody else do it. She's always willing to volunteer to help, but it's a position of service. Her, along with Lucy, they will be an extension of the pastor, counseling. I may need them for counseling, a female, altar work, visitation, maybe hospital visitation, along with teaching and preaching, which they both will be doing in the fall. I'm sure their roles will evolve with time. I'm sure they'll have other future assignments. And I just thank the Lord that both of them, Lucy and Jen, as commissioned ministers, the regard that they have for authority. I want to tell you one of the things I always respected the authority. You know, the Bible says to obey them that have the rule over you and submit yourself, for they watch for your souls. Hebrews 13, 17, what a wonderful principle to honor and to obey the authority. Jen and Lucy, they will not be referred to as pastor. By the way, Jim Cimbala over at Brooklyn Tabernacle has about 70 staff members on staff. They are all referred to as minister, Minister Tom, Minister John, et cetera, et cetera. But he's referred to as the pastor. So we won't be referring to them as pastors, but as ministers. So it's going to be Minister Jen and Minister Lucy. I like that, right? Hey, you know what, friends? My goal is to edify the church. My goal is to reproduce myself, to stretch us. At one of the recent staff meetings, I mentioned to them that my goal is to maximize their spiritual potential. If you will allow me, I'll do it. I'll stretch you. As the Lord stretches me, I'm going to stretch you. Are you with me? Good leaders create leaders, not followers. I'm not here to develop groupies that will follow Tony. I'm here to develop leaders. Amen. Come on now. Sometimes these leaders want people to be a groupie. No. Can other people be considered for the credentialing process? Yes, that's my prayer. That's my goal. And we're going to have the Berean School of the Bible coming up. And amen. Come on, in September, there's going to be future leaders coming out of that. Amen. By the grace of God, I'm going to stretch you. Amen. At this time, I'm going to ask Jen if she would come forward. I'm going to read her certificate. And Pastor Orlando is going to join me because he's going to pray for her. Jen, you're appreciated by everybody, Jen. Amen. Calvary Pensauken Church certifies that Jennifer Flaherty is hereby recognized by Calvary Pensauken Church of the Assemblies of God as a commissioned minister of the gospel. Congratulations, Jen.
Thank you so much, everybody. I'm really overwhelmed, Pastor, for those kind words. First and foremost, thanks and so much to my Lord and Savior. I entered into this amazing love relationship in 1997. I was on the path of doing what I wanted to do. It wasn't bad. A lot of it was very good, but it wasn't God. Amen? And he just arrested me in my bedroom, and I fell to my knees and said, "What must I do to be saved?" It was the start of the passion that's on the inside of me to serve him, and I have not looked back from that point on, and I've had some wonderful people in my life along the way. You know, when we're in the will of God, God puts those people in our path that we need for that season, and that's the word that always resonates with me, season. You know, I thought that maybe this would have happened after I did my 20 Bible classes, but that wasn't the season. I entered into a season of being a mom to this amazing human over here, and I'm going to embarrass him. And you know what? That was my mission for that season. And then, you know, maybe there would have been another time when I thought it would have been the season. But in 2015, I brought this. In 2015, I had the opportunity to go to a Proverbs 31 conference in North Carolina called She Speaks. And part of the assignment one night before we had dinner, we all had these rocks on our placemats, and we didn't know what to do with them. And then the speaker, Lisa Turkhurst, came up and she said, I want each of you to just take a few minutes right now, hear from the Lord, and write whatever he says on the rock. And what I wrote on the rock was, teach my word. And I knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that that is something that the Lord has called me to do. And so we don't have to wait for opportunities to be in front of the pulpit to be able to teach. And so right away I said, well, who wants to get into a Bible study? And, you know, I had some women and started doing Bible studies in the home, and we love meeting together and doing small groups at church and looking for opportunities to even go sit one-on-one and just go through the word. There's so many opportunities when we want to serve the Lord that he brings our way. It doesn't always look like what we think it should look like, but they're awesome opportunities, and I took every single one of them. And as a result, I just know the Lord is pleased, and I'm so thankful to be standing here. And then I walked in here, and it was almost like I could have just fallen out because I just said, oh, I'm home. You know, I didn't come here looking for a new church. I didn't come here looking for a new church. I came here because Jess said, hey, my dad needs some help. Go help him. And that's me. I'm a servant, so I came and helped, and then I just fell in love with y'all, and so I couldn't be happier to be here, be part of this church. I love that we're growing together. I love what the Lord is doing here and how he's strengthening us and encouraging us, and I'm just so thankful for each and every one of you. Amen.
Pastor, you want to pray? Yeah. Thank you, Lord.
Yes. Thank you, Lord. Guys, if you could just bow your head and join with me in prayer. Thank you, Jesus. You're so good, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that we're able to just celebrate this time, Lord Jesus. And Lord, I just pray with all the power and authority you've given me, Lord God, to activate Jen, Lord, to this next season in her life, Lord Jesus, that you would pour out your spirit on her, Lord God, and give her a double portion, Lord Jesus. That in this next season, Lord God, in this next chapter of her life, Lord, in this next glory that you've brought her to, Lord Jesus, that you would use her, Lord God, in a mighty and a profound way to edify, build up your body, Lord, to equip your body, Lord Jesus, and to be a servant, Lord God, which is what you've called all of us to be, Lord God. But we're thankful, Lord, that we have people like Jen that are the example, Lord God, of what it means to serve, Lord, and to serve wholeheartedly, Lord God. So I just pray that you continue to allow that zeal within her to just grow, Lord God, that she would not take her foot off the gas pedal, God, but that you would continue to just fuel her bones, Lord God. Let it be a fire within her belly, Lord Jesus, that she cannot contain, Lord, but that she would pour out, Lord God, herself as a liquid offering to your people. And I know, Lord, that at the end, Lord Jesus, she's going to be so thankful and glad that she gave her life to you, Lord Jesus, and that you were able to use her for your good purpose, Lord. So we just thank you for what you're going to do in and through her, Lord, and in and through this church, Lord Jesus, as we all grow together, like Jen said, Lord. And we don't want nothing more, Lord God, and nothing less, Lord, than for you to be here with us and the power of your presence, Lord God, to continue to inspire us, to continue to keep giving you all the glory, honor, and praise. So we ask these things in your wonderful name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Bless you.
Jen, bless your heart.
Yes.
Bless your heart. Thank you, Pastor. Hey, let's stand together. Greet someone next to you before you're seated, okay? Amen. God bless you. Praise God. Praise God. You guys ready to receive the word?
Yes.
Amen. Amen. I'm going to ask the ushers if they would pass out the handout. Our topic this morning is on the threefold ministry of the church. Have you ever wondered, what is the purpose for your salvation? Why did the Lord save you? Is there a reason why the Lord saved you? Well, you're going to find out today why. We're going to share with you the threefold ministry of the church. And friends, I want to challenge all of us. If you are a Christ follower, if you have accepted Christ into your heart and you know him as your Savior, that you would know these 3 points. The threefold ministry of the church. And we're going to have Minister Lucy. Amen. We love Lucy. She is the CEO of Faces of Change. I tell you, I thank the Lord for Lucy. Even at the picnic, she was ministering yesterday. I saw her. Right? Yeah, I know. That's your heart. I saw you. So we're going to go over the threefold ministry of the church. And when you leave today, you're going to know why you were saved. What is your function? What is your duty? By the way, I may even ask you after the service. Do you remember the 3 points? So our ministry to the world is evangelism. Our ministry to the church is service. And Jen is going to come back and share concerning our ministry to the church. And then I'll pull it together with our ministry to God, which is worship. Amen. And again, my prayer, my goal for today is that not only that we have this handout to take with us, but all of us would understand and know what is my function, what is my role as a Christ follower. That is our ministry to the world, to the church, and to God. So first up is Minister Lucy. She's going to share our ministry to the world, which is evangelism. Bless you, Lucy.
Good morning. Congratulations, Minister Jen. And she has impacted my life. I met her a lot later than all of you guys did, and she is already on Faces of Change Board of Directors. So I don't know how she does it, but she's amazing, and I'm grateful for her in my life and in this church. But I'm going to jump right in because Pastor Tony threatened me if I stay longer than 10 minutes, all right? So I am speaking on reaching the world, evangelism, which is my absolutely favorite topic of all time. The Assembly of God defines evangelism as a core belief and ministry priority that involves delivering good news to people who need it most. We believe that evangelism is a mandate from Jesus Christ and that we are all called to evangelize the world as an agency for God. That was written by Robert E. Coleman in a paper called Theology of Evangelism. Evangelism is soul winning. Evangelism is a term that we use for preaching the gospel. It does have a Greek name, but I'm not going to try to pronounce that. But it literally means gospeling. Isn't that funny, right? So when you go out evangelizing, you're gospeling. I didn't know that either. When we accept Jesus Christ into our hearts, we received the free gift of salvation. And we should want to share that free gift with others so that they can be free and so they can receive salvation. God's desire is that all would be saved, that no one would be lost. John 3:16, we all know it. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever shall not perish but have eternal life. So he has commissioned us and given us a mandate. We are commissioned, right? And you can find this mandate in 4 of the synoptic gospels, and also in Acts, but we're just going to read one of them, which is Mark 16, verse 15. He said to them, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation." Go gospeling, that's what he said. Jesus told us to do this. The gospel is to be taken to every culture, every custom, every civilization, every ethnicity. It is to be taken to the world, to whosoever. Ephesians 4, chapter 11, 13, I'm going to read it really quickly. It says, "Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and teachers to equip his people for the work of service so that the body of Christ may be built up." So who is supposed to evangelize? It says God gave all of these, right, to equip the people, to equip the body of Christ. So we are all called to be evangelists. The church building, the church is building us up to be in full-time ministry. Whether you are specifically designated to like a position or just living your daily lives, you are in full-time ministry. That is what you are as a Christ follower. So we're called to reach the world with the gospel, right? Don't we realize that we have the answer for life? We are carriers of what the world is looking for. I think sometimes as Christ followers in this generation, we have forgotten because we have become so Americanized. Many times we hear Christians say, oh, some go and some pray and some give. And yes, if you cannot go, then then go a different way. Go on the phone. Invite people over. Go on your porch. Do your surrounding area if you can't go. And yes, we're all to pray and we are all to give, but we are all called to go. And going basically means that we are all called to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. Evangelism can happen anywhere, at a supermarket, in your community, at work, with your next door neighbors, at school. It can happen anywhere, and we need to be ready. There are basically three types of evangelism, and there's more, but these are like the core basic ones, which is number one is direct evangelism, which is preaching. It's directly preaching, usually to a few people, not just one. It's just getting the message out there. And then there is apologetic evangelism. It's when they're a person is a defender of the faith. They can go head to head with people, right? They're able to do their thing. And a lot of times we think of apologetics as being aggressive, but an apologetic doesn't have to be aggressive. They can tell the truth in love. They just know how to defend the faith, right? And then there's the testimonial evangelism, which everyone in this room can do. It is sharing your personal story. Nobody can counteract your story. Nobody can tell you that you're wrong because of your experience and how Jesus saved you and delivered you and set you free. It is your story. Amen. And so it's like John 9:25, the blind man, when he was healed, he went to the Jewish leaders and said, whether he is a sinner or not, I don't know. He was talking about Jesus. But he said, but one thing I do know, I was blind and now I see. And don't you know that that is your testimony too? You were blind, but now you see. Now we see. The next one is relational. It is building of relationships. This takes time, but it can be very, very effective. Many times people know if you're being genuine, if you're being authentic, or if you're just trying to convert them. It takes time. There's no rush. Building relationships with a person, showing them how much you care about them, you're interested in them. This is great, great evangelism tool. And then there's invitational, inviting people to church, friends, family, co-workers. People will usually accompany you to somewhere if, you know, they know who they're going with. They're going with someone. I don't know why the church has lost this. We used to, like, you know, really be inviting people. I'm speaking about myself too. Like, we need to get back to that. Let's get back to inviting people to church, right? This isn't a club. This isn't just a place that we go to just for us, and it's all about us, and it's all about me, and it's all about my family. This is, we have life's answers. We have salvation to a lost and dying world. If you can't do anything else, invite them to church with you on Sunday. Amen? The last one is service. And it's life-based. Our acts of service often speak louder than words. People are watching you, and the way you spend your life speaks loudly. For example, many of our friends, when we go on the street, they say, why are you doing this? Why did you come to help us, right? Our actions. And we always deflect and reflect to Jesus, and we always say, Jesus loves you so much that he sent us out here to tell you. You know, just something as simple as that. And so our actions, our service to the Lord. FOC, we do a little bit of unconventional evangelism. It's friendship evangelism, relational, testimonial, and service all wrapped in one. It's soul winning, being who you are and putting yourself in positions and in opportunities so you can have divine appointments. Amen. Being intentional. Our light shines brightest in the darkness. Right? Our light. This is where we come to get equipped. But we come here to get equipped to go out there and shine the light. We can look around and find the problem. Many times, evangelism is done when you find the need in a person's life. You find the hurt. You find the pain. You find the grief. Go to a funeral. They are ready for you to be pouring into because the grief opens up their hearts to receive. Many times it's when you find the need. We have found the need through addiction services so that we can bring the gospel because he's the one who's going to heal them of the addiction. But it's when you find the need in a person's life. Meet people at their need. The answer works best in the presence of a problem. Because sometimes people who have it all together, they don't feel like they need Jesus. They say, Jesus is our crutch, right? But even the richest person may have a struggle in their lives. They may be lonely. Maybe their daughter is lost on drugs. Maybe their spouse left. Everybody has a need. You just have to build that relationship to find it. Needs give an entry point into the hearts and lives of others. Jesus hung out with the needy, right? Matthew 9:12, on hearing this, Jesus said, it's not the health who need a doctor, but the sick. Soul winning is a high priority. You're going to let me know, right? Is a high priority in God's plan. In redeeming the lost, I'm going real fast. I'm like, I got 10 minutes. In redeeming the lost and sinful to a right standing relationship with Jesus, God uses us to carry out his plan. How awesome that he uses us broken people to carry out his plan. Like, we get to be a part of the plan. I don't know how, but we do. Even in our brokenness, God is amazing. Every Christian is commanded to be a soul winner. The majority of ministry happens outside of these walls. And I want to say this, prayer is essential to evangelism. And we must go out in the power of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will show us what to say, show us what to do. It prepares us. It puts us in the right place at the right time. It gives us the words when we don't even know what we're going to say. But when we spend time with Jesus, he equips us. You know, Pastor Al Toledo from DNA of a Leader, he says, be privately healthy so you can be publicly fruitful. The way to be privately healthy is to pray, is to spend time with God. So if you're not sure how to pray, commercial, Saturday mornings, 9 a.m., come on out and pray, and you will grow a deeper. If you don't know how to pray, come. You'll learn how to pray. If you want to grow a deeper relationship in the Lord, come and pray. I'm telling you, if this body could come together, it's been the Saturday. I'm not always able to make it, but when I am, it is so good and it is so rich. And we are praying for you all to come in because it's prayer that's going to change this church. It's prayer that's going to win lost souls. It's prayer that's going to answer your issues and your needs in your life. If we don't pray, all those things are not going to happen. People in the world are looking for some type of hope. Christians have done well in the area of information. We got a lot of information. But today's people are looking for so much more than information. They are looking for the power of God. And the power of God comes through prayer. You need to have an anointing when you speak so your words have weight to them so that they pierce right through the heart. So you want to be a great evangelist, you don't even have to come to Faces of Change. Like I said, you can do it wherever you're at, but you have to pray and spend time with Jesus so that he can make you a powerful evangelist. The Apostle Paul himself said in 1 Corinthians 2:4, my speech and my preaching were not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and power. God is once again raising up men and women to go into the world and fulfill the Great Commission. I don't know if you've noticed, we are in the last days. and we need to get ready. He is raising up a remnant to go who are bold, who are strong, and who are not afraid to preach the gospel. Amen. People who know what the church ought to do, people who are hearing God and acting upon his word, he is raising up a people who know what the ministry of church is and understand that it is extended through every member of the body. Ephesians 4:16, the whole body fitly joined together. We all play our part in evangelism and in the kingdom work. We need to be stirred up, church. We need to bring people in, and we need to go out and win those who are lost and dying. Amen? Amen. 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 Minister Jen.
And how great is this? So she came from the end of Ephesians 4, and I'm coming at you from the beginning. So I think the Lord is saying y'all should go home and read the whole book of Ephesians. So I'm going to talk about the second purpose of the church, which is service one to another. You might have heard, so she said gospeling. I'm going to say one to anothering. And because there's so many scriptures, we gave you this on the back of your sheet to look at another time. We don't have time to go through all of them because I too have 10 minutes. And so I'm going to take you where I felt the Lord was leading us for this time, and that's going to be on two points for us as we think about the church and service, which is being called to flow in unity and being called to flow in diversity. Not two words you often hear together, unity and diversity, right? But I'm going to show you through the scriptures that this is what God has called us to do. So let me start by asking you a question. What do you value? What value do you put on your salvation? Just think about for that a second. Just think about it. What value do you put on your salvation? Think of something you have that's valuable. Are you valuing your salvation above that? Because how we value our salvation, and we can all answer the question, what's the value of salvation? But we need to make it personal. How am I valuing my salvation? Because the way I value my salvation is going to determine how I love you. It's going to determine how I live my life, and it's going to determine how I serve. Because we're not called to do anything in and of ourselves. Amen? Everything that we do, it's for the Lord. So if your salvation hasn't affected your lifestyle, I need my glasses. If it hasn't affected your lifestyle, if it hasn't affected the way you talk to people, if it hasn't affected the way you treat others, if it hasn't affected the way you think, then you have a low appraisal of something that is very valuable. And you need to reappraise your understanding of your salvation. Amen? How you value your salvation, we live as members of the body of Christ, it directly impacts the unity and the diversity of the church. So we're going to look in Ephesians 4, if you can turn with me there. We're actually going to start at verse 1, but just by way of a little bit of background. So Ephesians 4, from Ephesians 1 to 3, Paul spent a lot of time teaching and talking about doctrine. He got them geared up. This is what you need to know about your rebirth, adoption, redemption, how God is pulling the church together. But now we go to chapter 4 and we see that first word, and the first word in my version is therefore. Therefore, I, Paul, a prisoner for serving the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of your calling, for you have been called by God. Amen. And if we were to go back to chapter 1, verse 1, we would see Paul is writing this to us. So when he says, you are called by God, he's talking to us directly. He's also talking as a point of being a prisoner for Christ. Right? So he could have said, I, Paul, a prisoner, beg you this. But he wants us to know he is physically in prison, but higher than that, he is a prisoner to the Lord Jesus Christ, to the salvation that he wrought in him, that nothing else matters except Christ and him crucified. And so he's saying, and he's begging. I love that word. It's beseech in the King James. He's begging us. Can you picture that in your head? It's not enough just to write. He's literally begging us, lead a life worthy of your calling. And so the key here is to know you have a calling, right? God has called us. So we would read that and we would say, okay, now how do I do that, Paul? Don't leave me hanging, right? How do we do that? And then he tells us in verse 2, always be humble and gentle, be patient with each other, making allowances for each other's faults because of your love. Make every effort to keep yourselves united in the Spirit, binding yourselves together with peace. And so here is the call to unity. He's saying, therefore, because you know all this, it's equally important that you give weight to the practice. So this is the practical. And when Paul says, lead a life worthy, that word worthy is kind of analogous to a balance. So we can't have all doctrine and no practice. We can't have all practice and very little doctrine. We will be out of balance and lopsided, and that's not what the Lord wants for us. We need a solid foundation in our doctrine, but then we have to apply it. And that's what Paul is saying in these verses. So we know that he's exhorting the church, the called out ones, because he's saying, lead a life worthy of your calling, for you have been called. So we are the church, we are the ecclesia, we are the called out ones. The Lord brought us from darkness into light. In 1 Peter 2:9, it says, but you are not like that. Like what? Like those that rejected him. For you're a chosen people, you're a royal priest, a holy nation, God's very own possession, and in another verse it says, the peculiar people, which that's how I rationalize when, you know, people rub me the wrong way. Ah, they're just a peculiar person, right? So as a result, it says in 1 Peter, you can show others the goodness of God, for he called you out of the darkness into the light. Amen? And how do we do this? So he's telling us in verse 2, he's saying, like, I'm living this, guys. I'm living humble, meek, patient. And this is what I want you to do. Always be humble and gentle. Humble being meekness, obedience, respect, modesty, meekness. Meekness is not weakness. There's so much strength in knowing that we have the power and the authority of Almighty God, but we can be meek. We can be kind. We can be long-suffering. You know, I was thinking back to when I first got saved, and when I was trying to work on that, because that was a tough one for me, the long-suffering, I would take a little sticky note sometimes if people were, like, really getting on my nerves. I'd write an L on it, and I would stick it on my forehead just to remember to be long-suffering. We have to do that. And so we keep the unity when we work on these areas of our life. And that's what Paul is saying. Don't stop just because you know who you are because of the doctrine. Learn who you really are. Learn who Christ made you to be. Learn that he didn't put in you pride, that's not from him. Learn that he didn't put in you anger and weakness and all the things that come up against us. So if I'm walking in humility, I'm going to look for ways to serve you. Amen? If I'm walking in meekness, then my strength will be displayed through kindness. I don't have to come angry at you. If I'm walking in long-suffering, I'm able to make allowances for others' faults. Because I'm patient, and I want to see you grow. How about if we all put this into practice? How about if we all decide that this verse 2 is for us, that we are going to walk according to the way that Paul is asking us to walk? Are we going to be a better church if we do that? Are we going to be more united? And then it goes on in verse 4 just to say, he's just showing us how much he wants us to be one. Verse 4, for there's one body, one Spirit, just as you've been called to one glorious hope for the future, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, and one God and Father who is over all, in all, and living through all. Does that sound like unity? That's the unity that he's calling us to. And so as we get ourselves ready to know that we have to walk in unity, there's going to be some soul searching. Amen? And that doesn't just happen without you spending time in the Word, without you spending time in prayer, without us spending time in worship. That's when he speaks to us. That's when we can get the change. You know, I was thinking about when I first got saved, I was on fire for the Lord, but I was like a wild child, right? I just was like, I would try and run ahead of everybody. Let's get this done. Let's get that done. You know, why aren't we doing this? Why aren't we doing that? I had a real critical spirit. I had very little humility, a lot of pride. And you know what? As a result of that, I would get spoken to, I guess is a nice way of saying it. But, you know, we know the real word is rebuked. And I can just remember being so many times at church and, like, being in an office, you'd knock on the door, and then the, you know, armor bearers would say, hey, the pastor wants to see you. What did I do now, you know? But each time I got the correction, I learned from it. And I allowed it to apply it to my life. I didn't get bitter. I didn't get resentful. What do I know? I'm crucified with Christ. You know, I'm living according to who he wants me to be. I was thinking about the time when I first got married to the most amazing man in the world. Amen. You know what I did? I put a little sign by the side of the bed. So every morning when I woke up, it was a quote from Paul. And guess what it said? I die daily. Because the two becoming one, not so easy, right? And I had to remember, again, I've been crucified with Christ. It's not about me now. It's about what God wants to do in and through our union. We have to fight for the unity of the church so that we can be powerful to the world. If we're fractured, they're going to see that, and they're going to know, what do I want to be part of that for? But when we are a unified body, then we can really make an impact. And the second area that I'm going to go through very quickly is just talking about the diversity. And the diversity comes through service. And when it says in verse 7, if we just can go to verse 7 in Ephesians 4, it says, remember we had 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. Now we have, however, he's given each one of us a special gift through the generosity of Christ. So Christ is so generous to us that he's given each one of us a special gift. Being a member of a church is not a spectator sport. You're part of a team. You're part of a body. You're part of the army of God. So our job is to discover what is that special gift for each one of us. And as we're going through, each person has a part and a place. No born-again believer has been overlooked in the distribution of the special gift because it says all. Amen? So I'm going to read to you as I'm getting ready to close out of Romans 12, 4 through 11, if you would turn with me. And it's talking a little bit about the gifts. Now, there's several places in the Bible where it talks about gifts. It's not an exhaustive list either. There's other things that could come up. But here we see in Romans 12, just as our bodies have many parts, and each part has a special function, so it is with Christ's body. We are many parts of one body, and we all belong to each other. In his grace, God has given us different gifts for doing certain things well. So if God has given you the ability to prophesy, speak out with as much faith as God has given you. If your gift is serving others, serve them well. If you're a teacher, teach well. If your gift is to encourage others, be encouraging. If it's giving, give generously. If God has given you leadership ability, take the responsibility seriously. And if you have a gift for showing kindness to others, do it gladly. Don't just pretend to love others. Really love them. That's a gift we can all give each other. Amen? Hate what is wrong. Hold tightly to what is good. Love each other with genuine affection and take delight in honoring each other. And verse 11. Never be lazy, but work hard and serve the Lord enthusiastically. Amen? So we need you. You're here, and we need you. We need your help, and you need our help here at the church, right? Because we all are part of this local body, and there is something here for each and every one of you to do. And so I just want to point to your attention the ministry involvement cards. If you're not currently serving in the ministry and you feel a call to come and join, there is something for you to do. Please fill this out, turn it in, come use your gifts for us. And I echo the words of Paul as I close in Ephesians 4:1. I'm begging you, lead a life worthy of your calling in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Wasn't that great? Our ministry to the world, what is it? Come on now. I'm going to quiz you after service. Listen, we really should know the 3 points. What is our purpose? Why has God saved us? Just to sit around and watch television? No, no. God has a great, great, marvelous plan and purpose for all of us. Thank you so much, Minister Lucy. That was powerful. We got to win people to ourselves before we win them to Jesus. Isn't that wonderful? Bless you. Jen, she's a gem, isn't she? Yeah. All right, now we're going to talk about worship. Did you know that there are more verses in the Bible that deals with worship than any other topic or subject? Can I say that again? There are more verses in the Bible that has to do with praise and worship than any other subject. So it is important for us to understand the principle of worship. John chapter 4, our Lord says, true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father is seeking such to worship him. I want to share real briefly 10 reasons why it is important for us to worship. Number one, worship is the highest priority of the church. Jesus tells us here in John 4, the Father is looking for and seeking those who will worship. Nowhere in Scripture do we see the Father seeking anything else, not even gifts, talents, treasure, but worship above all else. The Lord desires that we worship him, and there's a reason for that. When we develop a connection with God of adoration and worship, the outcome, the result will be service, will be evangelism, will be love. But true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. What does that mean? Spirit, the idea of our passion, of our heart, of our emotion. Truth, our head, our intellect, our knowledge. Friends, a sign of a healthy believer is one that worships our Lord. And everybody said, worship is the highest priority of the church. It is such a wonderful privilege, but it is also a duty. And in worship, we touch God, but God touches us. If you don't remember anything else about my devotion on worship, in worship, we touch God, but God touches us. After the resurrection of Christ, we have a cameo of the early church in Luke 24, 53. It says, they, the church, were continually in the temple, in the church, praising and blessing God. They spent time in church. What was their activity in church? They were worshiping God, praising God. It was a habit, a practice of the early church. May we do likewise. Number two, worship invokes the presence of God. Worship invokes the presence of God. Worship will unlock heaven's doors. You remember in the Old Testament when Solomon and Israel dedicated the temple, Solomon's temple, they began to worship. And the worship team and the trumpeters. And as they began to worship, the glory went up and then the glory came down. Friends, there's something unique and special when we begin to worship. It will invoke the presence of God. You know what, friends? See, worship, when we talk about that we have to worship God and it's important that we worship God. But it's just like God to encourage us to do something for him. But in turn, he turns it around and he uses it to bless us. I want to tell you, when you worship, you begin to get energized. When the praises go up, the glory will come down. Amen. Worship invokes the presence of God. I'm going to move on. Thirdly, worship is love responding to love. 1 John 4 says, we love him because he first loved us. We love because we had been loved. And when you understand how much God loves you, that he died for you, that he has a plan and a purpose for your love, you can't help but thank God, amen, and praise God and worship God. So in worship, we are expressing our love to the Lord in light of how much he has loved us. Number four, worship is spiritually therapeutic. And I often share that with you. Worship arouses the soul, amen. Sometimes when we come to church, Just like yesterday from the picnic, some of us got beat up a little bit. Some of us are tired and you're dragging in the church and you're dragging. But when you begin to worship, something happens on the inside. You're energized. Amen. Come on now. Praise God. The soul is aroused. We're refreshed. We're edified. Praise and worship sanitizes. It cleanses us. As we begin to worship, we take our eyes and our hearts and our problems, we put them on the side and we concentrate on the Lord. Worship sanitizes and begins to cleanse us. Worship and evil cannot coexist. When we begin to worship, all those doubts and all those worries and all that pain, it just begins to worship. Worship is the antidote for gloom and doom. Friends, if you're going through a trial, just get alone with God. Get in your prayer closet. Just begin to thank God for his love. Begin to thank God. Begin to worship God. Amen. You will be renewed. Amen. Worship dispels fear and dispels anxiety. Number five, worship whets our appetite for more of God. When we begin to worship, we open up our hearts. We open up our lives to the Lord's presence, to the supernatural. How often when we're just enraptured in worship and praise and adoration to the Lord, something unique happens. And when we do that, the prophetic can happen. The miraculous can happen. You remember years ago, we used to have the antenna to receive, when we worship, we become more receptive to God. Whatever the Lord has for us, when we begin to worship God, we become more receptive to the presence of God, to the voice of God, to the peace of God. So I encourage us during those times when we're challenged or having problems. I want to tell you, when I encourage people who are seeking the baptism in the Holy Spirit, you know what I tell them? Begin to worship God. Begin to worship God. And as you worship, God becomes real. The presence of God will come. Amen. Number six, worship is not predicated on our feelings, our emotions. I want to tell you, there are times you're not going to feel like reading your Bible, but you do it in faith. There are times when you are not feeling to come to church, but you know God has a plan for you to go to church. What I'm saying is our worship is not predicated on a beautiful sanctuary. Thank God for our sanctuary. It's not predicated on special music. It is predicated on we have a heavenly Father that loves us, that cares for us. We have a Savior that died for us. That's the motivation factor, not our emotions. Friends, sometimes our emotions vacillate, but we know we worship in spirit and in truth. The truth tells us God is worthy of our praise. He's worthy of our adoration. And as we do, as we praise God, God responds. Friends, I want to tell you, you can worship God in a dungeon. You could worship God in a jail cell. I want to tell you, a lot of times I'm driving by myself, I'm praying and worshiping. I got my eyes on the traffic, but I'm worshiping. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Help my brother. Help my sister. Lord, you know what to do. Come on, you can worship the Lord anywhere. Come on now. You know, I want to tell you, there's a guy in the Bible by the name of Job. I think Job was close to being a billionaire. If not, he was a multi-millionaire. And when he had everything, you know what? He worshiped the Lord. And you know what happened? God wiped it all out. The kids, the family, the mansion, and you know what? He still worshiped. Amen. Worship is not predicated on what we have in our wallets. Not predicated on our emotions or our feelings. It's predicated on God. We've been changed by God. God loves us. God has a plan for us, and he is worthy. He's worthy of our praise. Amen. Seventhly, worship can activate a needed miracle for our lives. In Acts chapter 16, Paul and Silas were arrested, and they were put in prison with shackles for preaching the gospel. And the Bible says at midnight, they were what? They were praying and they were singing hymns. They were worshiping the Lord. And you know what? The Lord caused an earthquake and the prison doors were open. And you know what? They led the guard to Christ. And then he took them home and his wife cooked them a homemade meal. I want to tell you, worship can activate a miracle in your life. Just worship. Begin to worship. Come on now. Things happen. When you know what, friends? when we worship, things happen. Things happen internally in our mind, in our thinking, in our attitudes. Things change. Circumstances change. Amen. Miracles happen. Worship can activate a miracle. Number 8, worship is an act of the will. Psalm 34:1, David said, I will bless the Lord at all times. In Psalm 103:1, bless the Lord, all my soul. It is wise, it is prudent for us to make the decision to worship. We have to make that decision. It's an act of the will. I will bless the Lord at all times. I will. It's an act of the will. Paul is in prison in Rome another time, and he was in prison in Rome several years. By the way, I had a chance to visit that cell. By the way, there was no weight room or cable TV at the cell. Cost us $5 to visit. I want to tell you something, friends. While he was in prison, he wrote the book of Philippians. That whole book, the theme is joy. Rejoice in the Lord always. Come on now. He made a decision to worship the Lord even in prison. It is a decision that we make. Friends, we will benefit from it as we make that decision. I encourage us when we come to worship, when we come to church, it's God's time. We're going to dedicate that time to the Lord. You say, oh, I'm not feeling good. Got to put that aside. Concentrate on the Lord. You know what I have found? As the praises go up, the glory comes down. Amen. Make a decision. It's a joy to worship the Lord. We touch God, God touches us. Amen. God, we touch God, God touches us. Principle number 9, both is worship is both individual and corporate. I mean, we see all over how it's individual, but it's also corporate. Psalm 150, verse 1, praise God in the sanctuary. The idea of corporate worship, everyone participating. You realize worship, I'm absolutely convinced. When you worship, you're going to prepare your heart for the message. The message of Jesus needs the presence of Jesus. When we worship, we're going to open up our hearts to the Lord, to what he has for us. If you're going to just sit and drab and murmur or complain, I don't know if you're going to get anything out of the service. Are you with me? I think worship will prepare ourselves for the presence of the Lord. Praise creates a climate of spiritual awareness, of spiritual receptivity. You know what we're saying in worship? Lord, here I am. All that you have for me, give it to me today. You know, I quoted earlier when I opened the service, John 1:16, out of his fullness have we all received. Our prayer should be, Lord, whatever you have, I'm willing to receive. All that you have for me, not a selfish, no, this is not so. All that you want me to be, I want to be it. All that you have, I want to receive it. When we come to church and open up our hearts and worship in adoration, we're saying, here I am, Lord, I'm open. Just come and fill me. Are you with me? He desires to give all of us his fullness. Psalm 22:3 says, God inhabits the praises of his people. A deer inhabits the woods. A fish inhabits water. God dwells in the midst of the praises of his people. Can I say it again? God dwells in the midst of the praises of his people. Friends, God is near to us as our praises are on our lips. Psalm 150, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Do you have breath? Praise the Lord. Amen. Make a decision to praise the Lord. Give him the glory. He is worthy. In worship, we touch God. God touches us. I'm going to ask our worship team to come back, please. We're going to close by putting my devotion into practice. We're going to sing a chorus together. I encourage you, friend, if you have never audibly worshiped the Lord, can I encourage you to do that today? Just worship, just with all your heart, with all your might, with all your being. Number 10, worship edifies and builds up the congregation. I think it is a healthy, healthy practice and experience for the church to worship the Lord. And by the way, you know what I have found? Our worship encourages others to worship. Our worship encourages others to participate. It's like a ripple effect. Worship is contagious. Have you ever been next to somebody and they're praying audibly and fervently and you get excited? You know, you get the spark, the spiritual spark. The same thing happens in worship. As you worship, you're going to bless somebody next to you. Amen. When we worship, we saturate the sanctuary with the presence of the Lord. We touch God. God touches us. I'm going to ask us to stand. We're going to sing, I Speak Jesus, and I want all of us to participate. I want to hear all of us worshiping the Lord. Amen.
Yes.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Everyone. As we lift your name. Glory to your name. Glory to you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus. Till every dark addiction starts to break. Declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus.
Everybody.
'Cause your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows. Burn like the fire. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over fear and all anxiety. To every soul held captive by depression, I speak Jesus. 'Cause your name is power, your name is healing, your name. Shadows burn like a fire.
Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, Jesus for my family. I speak the Holy Name, Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, and Jesus for my family, I speak the Holy Name, Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy.
Come on,
Jesus for my family, I speak the Holy Name. speak Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Praise you, Lord Jesus. Praise you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. We love you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord. We bless you and love you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. 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 Amen. Amen. Just have a question before we go. Do you know the threefold ministry of the church? I want you to know it, okay? Amen. Thank you, Lord. Lord, thank you for today. Thank you that we were able to honor Sister Jen. Lord, when one is honored, we are honored. So we thank you for blessing us and advancing the kingdom through Calvary Church in Pensauken. Pray, dear Jesus, your richest blessings upon all of us as we go our separate ways. Help us to be a blessing to one another. People that we encounter this afternoon, help us to let our light shine, God, we pray. We ask you these favors and graces in Jesus' name. Amen.